What's going on, guys? Welcome back to WWE Network and Show, where I, Graham G. Matthews, break down all the original content I watch on the WWE Network. Today, we're talking the elitist episode of WWE Photoshoot featuring Kane. There's been a lot of Kane content up recently on the network, from the Untold episodes with Team Hell No, and then Kane himself revolving around his debut 20 years ago. We've seen a lot of Kane recently on WWE TV. Also, his recent appearance on Raw about a month ago when he came back as Mayor Glenn Jacobs, won the 24/7 championship briefly, and then came out at the end of Raw only to be attacked by the Fiend Bray Wyatt. So, hey, I'm not complaining. I love me some Kane. He's not nearly as overexposed now as he was maybe 4 or 5 years ago when he was in the Authority. So I'm completely content with this amount of Kane. But this was a very good episode. A bit on the lengthy side, clocks in at around 27, 28 minutes, but it's well worth the watch. I mean, Kane has had such a legendary career in WWE from even before he debuted as Kane in WWE in 1997. He had a few runs in the company as Isaac Yankum DDS. He talks about that here. Fake Diesel. He talks about that here. He talks about wrestling before WWE altogether and Smoky Mountain Wrestling to kick this thing off. We hear him talk about his history with The Undertaker, with Paul Bearer, with Edge, with Big Show, and a lot of other people, which was really cool to hear about, so it's definitely worth the watch. The first picture we see here is of Kane with Al Snow, of all people, and the two of them at this point are the reigning Smoky Mountain Tag Team Champions. That's insane to me. That's a tandem I never knew existed until now. It's a really weird pairing on paper, but I guess it worked back then. This was well before Kane arrived in WWE. Maybe not too long before. But I guess Kane talked about how his partner was supposed to be Eddie Gilbert to win the tag team championships with. But something happened with him. He couldn't make it, or he left the promotion. I forgot what the reasoning was. But Jim Cornette, who obviously ran Smoky Mountain Tag Team Wrestling, or Smoky Mountain Wrestling, excuse me, he needed someone new to team with Kane. So they picked up Al Snow, who was apparently hot on the independent scene at that point. They chose Al Snow, and they became tag team champions together. It was around that point that Kane got a WWE tryout, almost as soon as he arrived, I guess, in Smoky Mountain, because Jim Ross, who was a commentator at Smoky Mountain, was also at the same time, I think, on his way to WWE, or was also working with WWE. He was kind of a talent scout even back then for Vince McMahon. Saw Kane, saw a lot in him, gave him the WWE tryout, and obviously the rest is history. Then he became Isaac Yankum DDS. That was his first official character within the WWE. Oh, you see the picture of the character, what he looked like, dressed up as Isaac Yankum DDS. And Kane says it was a face only a mother could love, because they intentionally made his teeth look gross, and he had the long curly hair at that point, just a really ugly demeanor about him. The whole story behind the Isaac Yankum DDS character, for anyone not familiar, was that Bret Hart and Jerry Lawler had this like 2-year feud, I think from 93 to 1995, and Bret Hart beat Jerry Lawler in that infamous Kiss My Foot match, and as a result of that, Jerry Lawler claimed that he got tooth decay from Bret Hart's foot being in his mouth. So he hired Isaac Yankum to be his dentist, and then he brought him into the ring to feud with Bret Hart that year at SummerSlam. At SummerSlam 1995, we got Bret Hart versus Kane before Kane was Kane. He said that he never really saw himself as a wrestling dentist. I mean, go figure. But he said the only real good thing to come out of that alliance was the fact that he got to team with Lawler for a little while, and that he got to be with, got to spend some time with him and learning about the business. It was soon after that when the character was scrapped. I guess he was in South Africa at the time. He was told to call Vince when he got back to the States, who told him about the fake Diesel character. So around that point, in 1996, Scott Hall and Kevin Nash left WWE for WCW. And the whole storyline, because WWE was bitter about them leaving, even though they were well within the right to leave, and it didn't really seem... I mean, obviously, Diesel was WWE champion for a long time in 1995, but, you know, they were offered bigger deals in WCW, and it was, well, it made sense for them to make the jump. So WWE incorporated that into a storyline. Jim Ross saying, oh, I found replacements for Scott Hall and Kevin Nash, even though they were already in WCW at that point. So they hired Rick Bogner to be the fake Scott Hall, who was already doing, I guess, a Razor Ramon parody character in WCW anyway. So after he was done in WCW, they hired him, WWE did, to be the fake Razor Ramon in WWE, which is a pretty cool story for him, I guess. He actually recently passed away only a few short weeks ago, I think. Chris Jericho and a bunch of others did a cool podcast tribute to him a couple weeks ago. But anyway, Kane was then hired to be, or was then rechristened as Fake Diesel, and it was stupid. Kane thought it was a really good concept. I don't know why. Kane is a very smart person. He's the fucking mayor of, Knox County in Tennessee or something like that. He's a very smart man. Why he said this was a good concept, I have no idea. We do agree on one thing, though. He did say it wasn't going to work because Jim Ross could not be a bad guy to the audience. He was way too beloved. He was way too good at his job to be a bad guy. So it didn't really work. But I think the whole thing was stupid to begin with. He did say he did defend it because he said that the character allowed him to get experience. And he only started wrestling, I guess, in 1991, and he was in WWE 4 years later. So he felt like when he was hired by the company as Isaac Yankem DDS, he wasn't ready for it at that point. But he knew he belonged in WWE around the time that he was doing the fake Diesel character, oddly enough. And he knew at that point that he could be a top performer with the right character. And that was as fake Diesel. I don't know when that run wrapped up. I don't know how long that lasted, but it could not have been too long, I imagine. We then see a picture of the Kane cape. The cape that he wore for a little bit anyway. It was very short-lived when he first debuted in late 97, early 98. He talked all about this in the Untold episode about Kane's debut 20 years ago. And I thought it was fascinating. And he kind of recalls the story here for anyone that didn't check that out. He talks about the Undertaker's house burning down and where he kind of, factored into that with his character origin and all that other stuff. He said he liked the character concept when he first saw it, the concept for the attire that Kane would be wearing. Because, again, a lot like he said in the Untold episode a few weeks ago, he said how the over-the-top superhero outfit that he would be wearing as Kane, like donning the cape and all, kind of was designed, the entire intention behind that was for it to overcompensate for his insecurities, after having his entire face burned and being, institutionalized and all this other stuff. Wearing the cape would make him think that he was a superhero and make up for the fact that he had a lot of issues. He had a lot of issues and he had a lot of things wrong with him. So I thought, honestly, that is really smart. And I thought it did kind of look cool on him. Not many people can pull off a cape. Kane did. But again, it was very short-lived. He might have worn the cape maybe once at a house show. I don't know if he ever wore it on TV. But we definitely saw the pictures of it here. And it definitely did happen, and that's why. And Kane thought it was a great idea. But he did not talk about how it was very short-lived and how it was scrapped soon after. We then see pictures of his iconic debut. He said the table had been set by Paul Bearer for months and months and months. He was going out there, rather appearing on the screen, saying, "Undertaker, you have a brother. Kane is coming. Kane is coming." So, when Kane did arrive, he did debut at Bad Blood 1997. Kane said that everyone already knew who he was after months of hearing about it, which was really smart. This I thought was fascinating. I tweeted this out earlier today, and I thought this was amazing. I never knew this, and maybe I'm just the world's biggest idiot, which is very possible. That is very likely. And everyone else already knew this. I did not. I thought this was amazing. Kane said that it was Undertaker's idea for Kane to do the whole where he lifts his hands up and then he throws them down and the fire comes out of the turnbuckles. That was Taker's idea. And that wasn't as fascinating as the fact where Kane said that the reason why he did that was because Undertaker would do the exact opposite. You know how Taker's on the steel steps and he raises his arms up in the air and he brings the lights on as he's making his iconic entrance? That's why he did that, because Kane would do the exact opposite. He would throw his hands down and not only would the lights go out, fire would come up through the turnbuckles. That is amazing to me. How I never realized that, I have no idea. I'm sure I'm not the only one, but I thought that was absolutely amazing. But he said that it was one of the more impactful debuts that ranks high, high up there in terms of like some of the best debuts of all time. And he's not shy in saying that, nor should he, because it is indeed one of the greatest debuts, if not the greatest debut in WWE history. We see a picture of Kane with Paul Bearer. He said that Paul Bearer was one of the greatest managers in the history of the business. He was very goofy backstage, a very nice guy, but he was also very instrumental in his success and also helped him and Undertaker achieve the success that they did. Without him, he probably would not be where he is today. We see a picture of Kane recalling his first WWE Championship win after, what was it, King of the Ring, 1998. He's still upset to this day, he said, probably half-jokingly, that Mick Foley overshadowed his title win, because it was on that same show, at King of the Ring 98, that Mankind and Taker had that unforgettable Hell in a Cell match. Though the real main event of that show was Stone Cold Steve Austin and Kane in a Bad Blood match, or rather a First Blood match, for the WWE Championship. That's where Kane won via, controversial fashion, and for the first time in his career, became a WWE champion. He obviously lost it back to Stone Cold the very next night on Raw, but he said it was confirmation that he could be one of the top superstars in WWE. We then see a picture of Kane with Pete Rose and tombstoning him back at WrestleMania 14. That was their first WrestleMania appearance together. It was also Kane's very first WrestleMania appearance, period. He debuted at that WrestleMania. That was his WrestleMania debut facing The Undertaker. So why they did that, it was a great moment, very funny, perfectly executed. Why it was Kane attacking Pete Rose, and not Undertaker, I'll never know. Because at that point, Kane was supposed to be this big bad heel. All right, people liked him because he was a badass, but he was supposed to be the heel in that feud with Undertaker. So why he was going out there and attacking Pete Rose when Pete Rose was portrayed as an asshole, I have no idea, but I thought it was a great moment nonetheless. He said that if he was not involved in baseball, if Pete Rose wasn't involved in baseball, he would have been a great heel in pro wrestling. And that kicked off a mini storyline between the two over the next few years of WrestleMania. He went on to tombstone him at the next two WrestleManias, 15 and 16, and they had a little run-in, I think backstage on when Pete Rose guest hosted Raw many, many years ago, like in 2010, I want to say. I think it was the last Raw before Undertaker or Shawn Michaels retired, actually, before Shawn Michaels and Undertaker too, because I remember Pete Rose setting up a match, what would end up being Shawn Michaels' final Raw match, against Kane. And obviously, given the history there, that's why he did it. And I don't think that he didn't really attack him on that show. Pete Rose might have been in a wheelchair at that point. But they did interact at that point. They didn't recall that here, though. And he called them awesome. Pete Rose was very awesome indeed, according to Kane, and I agree. We then see a picture of Undertaker, classic Taker from the Attitude Era from the early 90s. He said that he will never forget watching Undertaker come to the ring for their match at WrestleMania 14. Even if you're his opponent, you get lost in watching the Undertaker's entrance. And he said that Taker is one of the greatest characters in the history of the business, which is weird because normally that wouldn't be the case because he's this dead guy, but Taker makes you suspend disbelief. That's how good he is at what he does and always has been. He said that he had his first match with Taker well before he ever came to WWE. This might have been, I don't know when this was, maybe 93, 94. They had a match against each other in Knoxville. I mean, Taker debuted in WWE in 1990, so if it was before Taker came to WWE, then it must have been like 89, but Kane said he started wrestling in 91, so I don't know exactly when the match happened. Maybe it was like a tryout match for Kane. I'm not sure. I'm not really sure what that match would have been or when it would have happened. Maybe WCW? I don't think so. Before Taker came to WWE? I'm not really sure. I really don't know. But anyway, he said that that being Kane, would not be here today if it wasn't for The Undertaker. We then see a picture of Christian being chokeslammed by Kane. He says, jokingly, he never really liked Christian. And he recalled the time where he was talking to Christian in the airport, and Christian just randomly punched him in the stomach and then ran off. So as a result of that, he took advantage of every opportunity he had to chokeslam him during their feud in the early 2000s when it was Taker and Edge versus, Taker and Kane, the Brothers of Destruction, versus Edge and Christian for the tag team titles that year in 2000-2001. We then see pictures of Kane's Inferno match with The Undertaker from probably 1998, I think. It was after the WrestleMania match. It must have been Backlash. No, Backlash happened, I think, in 99 it debuted. I don't exactly remember, but they had an Inferno match at one point. And he said it was one of those things that he probably shouldn't have agreed to, but he did. It wasn't that bad. He said it only got really, really hot the closer that he got to the outside of the ring. If you were in the middle of the ring, it wasn't too bad. But obviously, you can't stay in the middle of the ring for the entire match. So the closer they got to the edge of the ring, to the ring ropes and stuff like that, it got really, really hot. And it made for great TV, according to Kane. I'm not a real big fan of those matches. They were a spectacle, but the matches themselves were no good. He said it was great TV, but he also said that it was very limiting because he didn't really know how much they could do within that environment. And it didn't help that they had to top themselves every single week in the Attitude Era, so they had to go out there and have this amazing five-star classic to top everything they had done up to that point. We then see pictures of him teaming with Big Show from their various runs together from 2011 to 2006. They've teamed a lot over the years. He said that was the one time in a tag team where he was the smaller guy because Big Show is bigger than him. And he also called Big Show a great athlete. We see pictures of him teaming with X-Pac back in, what would it have been, 1999, 2000? Probably one of the two. I think 2000, if I'm not mistaken. He said that he was an absolute killing machine back then. and that their relationship, the relationship on air between, on screen between X-Pac and Kane, was so important. It was important because that was when Kane started the show Feelings, and that was when fans realized, holy shit, this guy's a human being too. And X-Pac brought that out of him. We then see a picture of Kane as himself, Glenn Jacobs, sitting in a smart car during his campaign to become the mayor of Knox County a few years ago. He said that it was something that always interested him, and I guess, something that he had always been interested in doing. It took a lot of hard work, and he knocked on a lot of doors and met a lot of people, but he was elated when he won, and that he was also happy that the hard work of both himself and all the people that he worked with to get to that point had paid off beautifully. We see a picture of him crashing the wedding of Edge and Lita. That was around the time that Lita in storyline was married to Kane many, many years earlier. And he said that it was very over the top, but it was an awesome angle nonetheless. And that was when the wedding ended with Kane tombstoning the priest. And that it was one of the most memorable endings in to anything involving, you know, anything that happened on Raw in WWE history. And it was a great angle. Definitely something that wouldn't fly today, but it was a great angle nonetheless. The next picture we see is of when Kane first took his mask off, which might have been 2003, if I'm not mistaken. He talked about how it was when he lost a match to Triple H. It was on Raw, I think in June of 2003. And if he lost the World Championship match to Triple H, he had to unmask. And I guess one of the ideas from Bruce Pritchard, actually, he said, Kane called him out on it, was that he would have his head shaved halfway. Why? I don't know. Probably just to make him look more demonic or something. He thought it would be a good idea. Bruce did, but it obviously wasn't. It just looked stupid. So he just ended up shaving it all off. But anyway, he was actually in favor of the move to unmask himself because he said that he went as far as he could with the mask on. And he also brought up a good point, too, because you can't really use your face for like facial expressions and telling a story with the mask on. And he had really gone as far with that character as he could after wearing the mask for 6 years. He thought it was the right time to unmask. And he also said, let's see here, he also thought that he was limited in that respect in wearing the mask. So he thought it was the right time to take it off. He didn't really express any regret in removing it that year. It did kind of hurt a little bit of the mystique of the Kane character, but that was so far gone by 2003. I don't think it really mattered anyway. So regardless, we see the next picture of Kane with Imposter Kane, the angle that they ran in 2006, June of that year during the release of See No Evil, to promote the movie. That's why they were doing the angle. He said it was one of those things where the vision of it was that Kane had this vision of a character from his past coming to reality, and it ended up just being himself with the mask on from years earlier. Luke Gallows, he admitted, was under the mask. He was the fake Kane. But the angle didn't really come off as well as they wanted it to, so it was scrapped soon after. It ended up lasting maybe all of a month. They had a pretty subpar match, the Vengeance pay-per-view that year in 2006. It was very short-lived, and they scrapped it soon after. It didn't really amount to anything. And Kane said it was one of those cases where they have a vision for it, they have an idea for it, and it could be one of those things that's really, really good. But like a lot of the things that WWE does, it just ends up mediocre, and it's not as good as they envision it to be. So they just scrapped it. And it was a really weird storyline. I'm not really sure where it would have gone anyway. They had Kane lose to the loser, lose to Imposter Kane, and then kick his ass and X and out on Raw, throw him out of the building, and that was it. So I thought that was a little strange. I'm not sure if the idea was to get the Kane, you know, the mask Kane back, get the mask back on Kane. I don't know. But yeah, he did talk about that. I'm glad he did because that was kind of a weird storyline. We didn't hear him talk about See No Evil, which was a little disappointing now that I think about it, which was a big part of his career because that was when he first expanded into movies and stuff like that, doing See No Evil and See No Evil 2. But anyway, we see a picture of him with Daniel Bryan as Team Hell No from 2012. He said that that Team Hell No run, as he talked about more in length in that Untold documentary a few weeks ago, he said that it really expanded the reins of his character and that it was a radical departure from everything that he had done up to that point in his career. And that's why I enjoyed it so much because it was so different than everything else they had done that he had done specifically in WWE up to that point, which is really cool. And it paid off because they had great chemistry, they had really good matches, two top names, former world champions. And Kane has always been a big tag team guy, which I realized while watching this episode of Photo Shoot, which a lot of people probably already knew. And I realized that, but it didn't really dawn on me until watching this episode, seeing how many people, you know, he teamed with over a while, including, obviously, Daniel Bryan. He teamed with Big Show, he teamed with X-Pac, he teamed with, obviously, The Undertaker. He teamed with, also, The Hurricane for a very short period. So, yeah, you know, they had, obviously, a lot of chemistry, and it paid off, because the angle that they built up throughout the better part of 2012 going to 2013 was absolutely amazing and the best thing to happen to that tag team division in many, many years. Dr. Shelby, we see a picture of Dr. Shelby, and he said that he was a very integral part of Team Hell No. Said that the anger management vignettes, those skits were among the best that WWE has ever done. He also recalled the diner one, the diner scene that they did in Albany, New York, where they had to eat each other's food, and Daniel Bryan, because he was a vegan, had to eat meat, and Kane, you know, being a meat guy, had to eat like a salad or something, and Bryan ended up puking all over Dr. Shelby. I completely forgot all about that. But it turned into a Harry Met Sally situation at the diner where they're just kind of, you know, screaming and all that other stuff, which was a lot of fun. And we see Mae Young at the bar, and she comments on it, which was great. And he just called it a lot of fun, and it was a great angle. We then see a picture of him as Corporate Kane back from, which would have been maybe 2013 through 2015. He was Corporate Kane for a long time. He brought back Mask Kane for a little while in 2014, but for the better part of those 2-3 years there, he was Corporate Kane. He said that actually, you know, contrary to popular belief, that was one of his favorite characters because it showed everybody that he had some range. He could be an unstoppable monster, he could do the comedy, but he could also be the straight, you know, the straight man in the stable, or, you know, the guy that people would bounce jokes off of and just kind of be an asshole. It showed that he had range as a performer, and he really enjoyed that era of Corporate Kane, he admitted. And the last picture we see is of the Brothers of Destruction. He said that they always had chemistry as opponents, him and Undertaker, but people always really wanted to see them team. Not really so much fight against each other, but more so team up. They were one of those type of tag teams, which is why they've reunited so many times over the years. They probably have teamed more than they've feuded, dating back to 1997. And they teamed for a while, for a little bit in the late 90s, but more so in like the early 2000s, mid-2000s, late 2000s, winning many tag team titles, early 2010s, even as recently as Crown Jewel a year ago. Kane said that he has always wanted his teams to work, which is why they did, because he was always willing to adapt his character to whatever the WWE and that team needed. Like, he was a comedy guy with, you know, he was a comedy guy with Daniel Bryan, showed that he had emotion during that tag team with X-Pac, showed that he could be a badass with The Undertaker, showed that he could be the smaller guy with Big Show. Like, he's always been willing to play different roles and always been willing to accommodate his partner. And he actually credits the longevity that he's had in WWE to the fact that no matter what he's involved in, he wants that angle, that tag team, that company, WWE on the whole, to be a success. He's been a part of WWE now for, what, 22 years? Over 2 decades? Very few people can say that. And a big reason behind that is because he's always willing to change up his character, do what has to be done. You never hear any bad stories about Kane, that he's unwilling to work with this guy. He's always willing to do whatever, and that's why he's been around as long as he has. And he's an all-around great guy, too. You could really just tell from listening to him here on Untold and other documentaries. Kane is a really smart, a nice guy. He's doing a book tour right now, actually talking about how he ran for mayor of Knox County in Tennessee. So, got to check that out. Would love to meet him at some point. The guy seems really, really, really nice. But, yeah, that's another reason, too, because Kane has, you know, never been one to take himself too seriously, despite the fact he was this monster 20 years ago. He's done comedy. He's put everybody over. Kane has lost to pretty much everybody under the sun. Everyone from Undertaker, John Cena, to Roman Reigns, Seth Rollins, you know, you name them, he's lost to them absolutely. I can guarantee you that Kane has lost to everybody under that WWE umbrella. Past and present, because that's how good the guy is. And despite all of that, he can come back and still get a big reaction, because people love Kane. But anyway, this was a great episode of Photo Shoot. Absolutely check it out on the WWE Network. Again, clocks in at around 27, 28 minutes, so it's a bit on the lengthy side, but well worth the watch. Learned a lot about Kane's career pre-WWE, while in WWE, and even the Mayor stuff too. The only real nitpick, the only thing I think they should have acknowledged and should have talked about, would have loved to have heard about, especially now being Halloween, with Halloween being in 9 days, was the See No Evil stuff. He filmed the 2 See No Evil movies, one in 2006, and then the sequel years later in like 2013, 2014. And both movies I enjoyed. They're guilty pleasures of mine that I watch every Halloween season, despite the fact they are absolutely terrible, especially the first one. The second one is marginally better, but not by much. But they're still fun movies to pick apart regardless. But anyway, guys, thank you for checking out this episode of WWE Network and Chill. I appreciate it. Be sure to like the video, drop a comment, share the video, and subscribe to the channel for more content. All that stuff is greatly appreciated. We'll be back tomorrow here on the channel with an all-new hashtag, hashtag AskGSM, Thursday WrestleRant Radio excerpts, and then Friday, new network and show breaking down the latest episode of Total Divas airing tonight on the E! Network. So until then, guys, have a great rest of your week. I'm Graham GSM Matthews, and I'll catch your ass down the road.